Our subject for today is personality. Specifically, your personality, and even more specifically, your sales personality. Now, you probably heard people say many times, when I was born, they broke the mold. Well, in many ways, that's true, because no two of us are exactly alike. On the other hand, even though we do have our own personality, this is not to say that we can't make it better, because our personality is exceedingly important in our succeeding in life. Many a successful man, if you talk to him to any degree, will tell you that he did it mostly because of his personality. It's your personality that makes you get through to people. It's your personality that gets you where you want to be. And in sales work particularly, without a good foundation of a sales-oriented personality, you're bound to have trouble. So today we're going to discuss how to improve upon our present personalities and how to make them more sales-oriented. Now let's start at the very beginning. What is personality? Did you ever think about it? Did you ever try to define it? Supposing I said to you right now, give me your personal definition for personality. What would you say? What do you think personality is? Anybody, what would you say? Yes?
I would say it's a projection of yourself.
That's part of it. Any other ideas?
I would say personality is one's individual mannerisms which make them different from someone else.
Very good. Anybody else? Any other ideas? Yes?
I think I'd say that personality probably is the way a person generates his whole being to those around them.
Very good. Well, you see, there are so many ways of trying to define personality. We've been trying to define it for years. The best definition that we've been able to come up with goes like this. Personality is a psychic or mental atmosphere which we radiate about ourselves, producing an effect on others. You see how all-encompassing that is? It's a psychic or mental atmosphere which we radiate about ourselves, producing an effect on others. Now, obviously, if we produce a good effect on others, and if we're trying to sell something, we'll make the sale. But if we have a poor personality projection, if we don't produce the right effect, obviously we won't get through to people. Now, the way to understand personality best is to analyze it. Now, I'm going to break it down for you as best as we can. And as I do this, I'd like you to think about your own individual personalities and see how it all interrelates. First of all, there are four types of personalities. One is the engaging personality. That's the kind that gets people to like you. Now, that's important, isn't it? If people like you, they go out of their way to do business with you. Now, you'll buy that, won't you? If they like you, they go out of their way to do business with you. And I'll give you a perfect example of that. And this is something that all of us can relate to. All of us drive an automobile. And all of us every so often have to drive into a gasoline station, don't we? What happens? As soon as you drive in, first thing you do is you drive over the pipe, brings the bell inside, and there's the guy sitting with his feet up on the desk, reading the sports page, and he gives you that awful look, as if to say, you bother. Does he run out to try and help you? No, he just ambles out very slowly. Finally, he comes up to you and he says, yeah, and you say something like, well, fill it up with high test, please. He doesn't say a word. He goes to the back of the car and he fills up your tank. Thank you. You give him the money or your credit card. He completes the transaction, gives it back to you, doesn't say thank you. You say thank you to him, and in disgust, you drive away. And you say to yourself, and they call this place a service station? But think about the very rare occasions, I will admit, when you've driven into a gasoline station and a bright young guy runs out and says, yes, sir, may I help you, with a big smile on his face. And you tell him what you want, and he says, yes, sir, and he runs around and he does your windshield for you, checks your oil without being asked, gives you all the service in the world. You give him your credit card, he looks at the name, and he says, yes, Mr. Jones, right away, and he writes you up. He says, thank you, Mr. Jones, come back again, et cetera, et cetera. He treats you just like you want to be treated. And even if they charge you 2 cents a gallon more, you'll still go back because they're you as you like to be treated. So if people like you, they go out of their way to do business with you. Well, now, what makes people like you? You ever think about that? What makes people like you? Well, a person will like you because he figures that you think as he does. Your neighbor likes you because you mow your lawn when you're supposed to, so it looks nice next to his. Your neighbor likes you because you don't go in and interrupt his privacy unannounced. He doesn't do it to you. He doesn't expect you to do it to him. Once you violate these rules, they don't like you anymore. But there are more rules than that. For instance, a very good rule to remember in developing an engaging personality is to never, never think or talk about yourself boastfully. You see, 94% of the time, people are thinking about themselves. Psychologists have proved that. Now, if you want to get on the good side of anybody, if you want to get on the engaging side of people, if you want to draw them out, if you want to get through to them, you don't talk about yourself boastfully. If you want to talk about him, his most favorite subject, this he'll buy. But he doesn't want to hear about you. Think about the last time that your brother-in-law came to your house for dinner and he spent one solid hour telling you how great he is and you got nauseous. Isn't that about right? Isn't that what happens? Now, if you adopt that rule, you're on your way to an engaging personality. Here's another rule that you should follow. Be considerate of everybody. After all, anyone that you come in contact with is a human being just as you are. They have the same problems, the same mortgage problems, the same tuition bills. Everything is the same. And yet, do you talk to your boss the way you talk to your associate or the way you talk to your garbage man? Is there a difference? If there is, you're not being considerate of everybody. And you're not developing that part of your personality. And one more rule, and then we'll go on. Smile. That's very important, extremely important. If you smile, you radiate happiness. If you always have a frown on your face, you're radiating gloom. There's enough gloom in this world of ours, and particularly in sales work, if you walk around radiating gloom, you're gonna get thrown out. Walk around with a pleasant smile. I don't mean one of those ridiculous anteater jobs. I mean a smile that really comes from liking people. And you should like people. If you don't like people, then don't get into any situations where you have to earn your bread and butter by doing business with people. All right, enough about the engaging personality. The second type of personality is the assuring personality. And that's the kind that gets people to believe in you. Now that's important too, isn't it? People should believe in you in order to do business with you. Well, you know, it's amazing how many people like to lie. It's been said that salesmen do to the truth what whipping does to cream. They just change the consistency a little bit. Well, that's bad. And a fellow says to the salesman, listen, I need this stuff and I need it in 2 weeks. Can I get it? He says, don't worry. And you know what he's saying. He's saying, there's no way, but I'm not going to tell you, fella, because I'm not going to lose the business. You see, that's one of the worst things you can do. You've got to never tell a lie. That's the rule I'm driving at. Never tell a lie. It's the worst thing you can do in business, because they'll always remember you as the individual they cannot trust. It's a funny thing. You can tell the truth for 10 years and they'll expect it. They never once say to you, gee, how nice you are. You're a great guy. You always tell the truth. Don't look for that. You'll never get it. But you tell one little white lie and get caught at it, and from then on, the standards are all gone. You are earmarked as a liar, and they'll always figure that you're a liar. The other rule under the assuring personality is that you must know your product or service and know it well. You must know it so well that you can then avoid the horrible thing that happens over and over again when they ask you a question. You have to say, well, I really don't know, but I'll find out. Well, how many times can you pull that on anybody, saying, I really don't know, but I'll find out? Do it two or three times, and the prospect might very well say to you, now, why don't you go back and learn all about your product, and when you know what it's all about, then you can come back and sell it to me. And he'd be right. It's fundamental. You must know your product, and you must know it well. Enough about the assuring personality. Let's go on now to the third type of the personality, which we call the compelling personality. And this is the kind that gets people to act on your recommendation. Remember, that's the close, really. The close of any order, the close of any sale. When you can get people to act on your recommendation, you've gone the whole way. Now, let's examine this a little bit. How do you develop a compelling personality? Well, for one thing, you must remember at all times that you have to develop powerful self-control. What do we mean by powerful self-control? We mean simply this. If you don't expect and get things from yourself, how can you possibly expect to get others to act on your recommendation? Think about that. You must expect and get things from yourself to begin with. Oh, I can give you a perfect example of this. It happens all the time. In this part of the country, in the Northeast, as we all know, in the fall of each year, a salesman or anybody else, any man of the house, on a weekend, he comes home on Friday night, and the wife will say, listen, this weekend, I've got a little job for you. I want you to take down the screens and put up the storm windows. It's that time of the year. And he says, don't worry. Right? Fine. Well, Friday night goes by, and Saturday in the morning, he's got a golf match. In the afternoon, he goes out with the boys and plays a little ball. On Sunday, he has a few pro football games on television that he wants to see. The whole weekend's gone. No storm windows. Following weekend, Friday night, he gets the same story from the wife. He says to her, don't worry, this weekend I'll really do it. The whole weekend goes by, and this goes on, weekend after weekend. Finally, on a Friday night, he comes home, and she says, listen, stupid. We're heating the town. This weekend, you're not leaving the house until you put up the storm windows. And then there's a slight set-to, but finally he puts up the storm windows, and that's the end of that. Now, this is the very same guy who Monday morning through Friday afternoon is making sales call after sales call, telling people why they should act on his recommendation. But he can't make himself put up the storm windows in his own house to avoid heating the town instead of his own house. Now, that doesn't make sense, does it? That's what we mean by developing self-control. If you can do that, if you can expect things from yourselves and get them, now you're developing a compelling personality. Now you're on the right track. You can get people to act on your recommendation. The other thing that you must develop is determination. You must develop determination to the nth degree. Set certain goals for yourself as to how many calls you're going to make, how many sales you're going to make, how many people you're going to convince. No matter what the situation may be, set those goals and then have the determination to make them come true. As many times as you will say to yourself, I've got this goal to meet and I must meet it today or tomorrow or this week or this month, as often as you can get yourself to remind yourselves of those goals, you are working on the determination part of your compelling personality. Okay, now, there's only one left. We've had the assuring, the engaging, and the compelling. The fourth one is the dynamic. Now, how many people in this class think they're dynamic? Can I have a show of hands, please? One, two, three. Well, this is an unusual class because the number of people in the entire world who are really dynamic is infinitesimal. Imagine that. Very, very, very few, maybe one in 10,000 or 20,000. And the reason for that is, so you didn't know how unusual you were. The reason for that is that to be dynamic, you have to have a balanced combination. Now listen to that word, balanced combination of all three of these. By balanced, we mean you can't work too hard at getting people to like you. You could become sickening. You can't work too hard at getting people to believe you. If I went over to Frank here and I said to him, and listen, Frank, and I'm telling you the truth, and I'm telling you the truth, and I'm telling you the truth, he'd figure he must be lying. Isn't that true? So you can't work too hard at getting people to believe you because then it's too obvious and you're pushing too hard. It has to be a balanced deal. And finally, you can't work too hard at being compelling because if you work too hard at that and you're making a sales call, you might get thrown out. I had a salesman who walked in my office one day and he said, boy, am I compelling. When I go in and I make a sales call, I pound on the desk until the inkwell dances. Well, I couldn't tell him what I really thought of that. But that's being altogether too compelling. You make a man's inkwell dance, and you're pretty well sure that you're going to get thrown out. So if you have a balanced combination of all three, then you might become dynamic, but there are two other ingredients. And let me just jot these down here because they're extremely important. One is confidence. Where does confidence come from? It comes from knowing that you can do something, right? Nobody can give you confidence on a silver platter. You must know that you can do something. So you must go out and do what you think that you must do. And once you've done it, you develop confidence. And as often as you can repeat what you need to do, if it's selling that you're in, every time you make a sale, now you know you can make that sale. Confidence builds up in your system, and you'll be able to make the next sale a lot quicker and a lot better. That's where confidence comes from. You must talk to yourself about it. You must develop it within yourself. You must say to yourself, I know I've done it before, therefore I can do it again and do it even better. The other ingredient is enthusiasm. Now, you notice how you say that word? Enthusiasm, not enthusiasm. Enthusiasm, you must be enthusiastic every time you say that word, enthusiasm. Where does enthusiasm come from? It comes from getting excited about what you do. You must like your job, because if you like your job, you'll do it well. If you don't like your job, you'll never succeed. I can't stand the individual who says, boy, do I hate Monday morning. I feel like saying to him, you're a darn fool. If you hate Monday morning, you've got a big problem. Number one, you'll never do what you're doing well because you dread Monday morning. And number two, can you imagine? 1/7 of your life will be spent on Mondays. And that's a lot of time to spend on a day that you dread. If you can't stand Monday morning, if you dread Monday morning, get another job. If you look forward to Monday morning, you're in the job that you belong in, and most often you'll do it well. This business of enthusiasm is something that's so important personality-wise because I've gone through something in my lifetime that I shall never forget. It taught me the lesson. The first job I ever had in selling was with a small pharmaceutical company. The president of the company was a short, 5'2" individual, and boy, was he enthusiastic. He was dynamic, no question about it. He used to come from New York to Boston once a month to run the sales meeting for the New England sales manager, the New England salesman. And I remember the very first sales meeting I ever went to, there were 15 of us there. And before he started the meeting, he says, okay, before we get started, I want each and every one of you to stand up and give me your personal definition of salesmanship. Now, you get caught with a question like that at 9 o'clock on a Saturday morning out of a clear blue sky. What do you say? How do you define salesmanship just like that? No warning. Well, we all got up one at a time and we took a stab at it. And he'd say, well, that's part of it. That's part of it. That's part of it. Fine. When we're all through, he says, okay, men, you're all on the right track. But let me give you my personal definition of salesmanship. As far as I'm concerned, salesmanship is nothing more than a transfer of enthusiasm. If you can transfer your own enthusiasm about your product into the guy you're trying to sell, more often than not, you'll sell him. And you know something? That might not be the most scientific definition of salesmanship. You might not find it defined that way in the dictionary, but we went out and we found that he was right. We had products that the doctors and the druggists had never heard of before. We had trade names they never heard of before. It was a very small company. We'd walk in and say, we're from such and such company. He'd say, who? And that's an awful hole to climb out of for a salesman. And then after we told them exactly who we represented, then they'd say, okay, what are your products? And we start rattling off these trade names they never heard of. They say, gee, I never heard of those either. And it was difficult. But this young guy would pump us with enthusiasm once a month. We'd go out and we'd act so enthusiastically about those products that we made sales. And the proof was in the pudding. And we're all on commission, by the way. No expenses, no car, no nothing. Just commission. High commission, but just commission. And enthusiasm spelled the difference. Okay, that's the whole story on personality, on sales personality. Now, we have spent about 25 minutes today talking about your personality. Now, when's the last time that you had the opportunity of thinking about your personality for that amount of time? You see, whenever you think about it, you should go before a mirror and look closely and say to yourself, is this the type of person that I'm apt to buy from? Is this the kind of personality that turns me on? If you get the right answers, you're on the right track. If not, you've got a little work to do. Think about the things we talked about here today, because improving your personality means more success in selling or whatever else you do. Thank you.